Dudley was a clown.
I think he's one of the best physical comedians I've ever seen.
Oh, God. You have all...
Oh, little chap with a delightful face, immense charm.
Give us a squeeze with your eyes, doll.
He was a star before he ever came to America.
Dudley Moore.
Thank you very much.
Musician. Performer.
Under these gossipers, there's a passionate fairy trying to get out!
Movie star.
Dudley Moore.
He had it all.
I mean, he was very handsome. He had an enormous talent.
I was just my charming self.
This is a little East End lad whose mum goes out and buys him a piano. And he just takes off from there. It's the most lovely, lovely story.
Dudley Stuart John Moore was born in 1935 in Dagenham, in the East End of London, to railway electrician John and his wife Ada.
Life was very organised, very quiet. His mother and father, apart from the church, didn't go out very much.
Dudley was born with a club foot and one leg shorter than the other, and as a child underwent a series of operations to try and correct this.
I think his mother carried a certain degree of shame about having had what she regarded as a less than perfect child, and I think this possibly weighed on her.
She wouldn't allow him to come out and play. She would lift the flap of the letterbox and scream, "He's not here," when they all knew perfectly well that he was.
At school, the small boy with the club foot was firmly in the sights of the bully boys.
I, at the age of 13, having had my trousers pulled down regularly every day, not with delightful consequences, I suddenly decided in an English lesson that I would make a joke. I was, tired of this sort of treatment. I made a joke. Everybody looked round. Is he making a joke? And from that moment, I became a sort of clown.
And suddenly, he'd found the trick. If you can make them laugh, you've got them in the palm of your hand.
Dudley soon expressed an interest in music, singing in the church choir and playing the family piano.
Dudley would have his lesson first, and I would have my lesson. And he used to sail through his lessons, but I always used to get my knuckles wrapped because I never used to play so well.
I believe he also played the violin too when he was much younger.
I haven't got enough bow for this.
By the end of his secondary education, Dudley was so proficient that he was offered an organ scholarship to Oxford.
When Dudley first went up, he found it very difficult having come from Dagenham because he didn't speak like the people around him. He was very short, and the sons of gentlemen tend to be 6 foot tall.
So Dudley sought out friends he could connect to with what he knew best, music, and joined jazz band leader John Bassett for regular late-night gigs in the student union's basement.
It was, in a sense, like a drug, both for me and for him, jazz. And he came down frequently.
When he left Oxford, Dudley decided to pursue a full-time career as a jazz musician. Then, in 1959, came an offer from his old band leader, John Bassett, who was putting together a student review for the Edinburgh Fringe with Dudley's fellow Oxford cohort, Alan Bennett, and recent Cambridge graduates, Peter Cook and Jonathan Miller.
We met at a restaurant in the Euston Road and rather guardedly took account of one another. And then I think we agreed that it might be possible to put a show together.
That show was Beyond the Fringe, and when it opened in Edinburgh in 1960, the caustic mix of humour based on politics and class caused a sensation.
It was astonishing. It was as shocking then as the Jerry Springer opera.
Meanwhile, as invasion threatens, England is blanketed in security.
Now, wait a moment, we'll put Lyme Regis where Great Yarmouth was.
Right, Ipswich where Lyme Regis was.
And Great Yarmouth where Ipswich was.
Oh, that'll fool the boss, eh?
I'll fool him, bye-bye.
Bye-bye,
here, how do we get home?
I mean, when you take the characters, they were, again, all very tall men, some of them quite posh. And so Dudley, again, was slightly the odd man out until he played the piano. And then he transformed the whole thing.
But he practiced that at parties, you know, when he was about 17 or 18. And he was doing it long before Beyond the Fringe.
The fascinating thing about Beyond the Fringe is that actually, of course, it was seen by so few, astonishingly. But it was a seed ground, obviously, for all that has come later. It really was.
During the show's London run, Dudley could often be seen afterwards tinkling the ivories at Peter Cook's establishment club.
He played the piano in the basement there, usually surrounded by women.
His allure was quite remarkable. Right from the earliest days, it became apparent that he had an extraordinary hypnotic power over a particular sort of woman, rather idiotic dolly girls.
1962 brought even bigger success for Beyond the Fringe when the show moved to New York for 2 years. But then Dudley would get an offer from back home that he couldn't refuse.
The BBC asked me, did I have any ideas for a comedy show, for a pilot? And I said, yes, the Dudley Moore Show.
As the show would feature not only Dudley, but also his weekly rota of guest stars, it was renamed Not Only But Also.
And I think Dudley felt a little insecure, because he may have had the musical talent, but what was going to fill the rest of the half hour?
He said, what about asking Peter Cook to be in this show?
You don't happen to have another suit with you, do you?
Not on me, no.
No.
Peter was in fact only a guest on the first episode, but it soon became obvious that he and Dudley clicked, and he became a permanent part of the show.
£100,000 we pay for that. Those nude women come out of our pocket, Dad.
Yeah.
Well, you could get the real nude ladies over there for that price.
Yeah.
My Aunt Dolly would have done it for nothing.
She does anything for nothing, doesn't she?
Yeah.
Filthy old cow.
Peter never learned the script, because he would suddenly leave the script and improvise something, and that was when you would see Dudley completely hysterical with laughter, unable to go on because he didn't know where Peter was going.
You enjoying that, Sally? Mine's appalling, I'll tell you that much.
Dud and Pete was inspired more by Dudley's knowledge of the working class in Dagenham. It is the way that people in Dagenham would speak, and you would hear those phrases that Dudley used in Dud and Pete.
I'll go down here,
yeah.
I'll fling open the door. You never guess, there's bloody Anna Magnani up to her knees in rice, screaming at me. Let's see more in trotty, and more he made poor favori.
Italian,
yes, he was covered in mud, she grabbed hold of me. We rolled all over the floor.
Yeah.
I picked her up, I said, get out of here!
Yeah.
Get out of here, you Italian thing. I said, get out of here!
And it was the Morecambe and Wise of its day. I got a phone call from John Lennon saying, if you're doing anything with Dudley Moore and Peter Cook, can I be on it?
What about the other three?
You couldn't afford them, Dudley.
Oh.
In a strange way, it was like a masterclass when you worked with them.
Thank you very much. There's no need to follow me everywhere.
Oh, what?
Mr. Spigot, you are auditioning, are you not, for the role of Tarzan?
Right.
Peter readily acknowledged that he never did better work than that. And I think Dudley felt the same way.
I've got nothing against your right leg. The trouble is, neither have you.
The late 60s and early 70s saw Peter and Dudley try to turn their TV partnership into a film career without much success. So, in 1972, they returned to the stage with Behind the Fridge. But during rehearsals on the afternoon of the opening night, Dudley was whisked away by a camera crew to appear on This Is Your Life, with Peter Cook in tow.
So Peter was in the green room watching this and being handed bottles of wine. So when Peter came back, he was legless. He was absolutely drunk.
I tend to drink too much.
Why?
In fact, why? I don't know. I think it's a symptom of boredom, really.
And every time Peter came off, Peter would cry, say, I'm so sorry, I'm so sorry. And during the film inserts, which we had, Dudley would come off and say, he never said he's sorry to me, ever. And this was really the first time I noticed this relationship that was developing.
I mean, my problem is on stage, I tend not to concentrate. And this is the thing which Dudley will get worried about and say he may say I'll go two performances with being a bit vague.
Why do you, in fact, not concentrate for two performances? Why do you make me get into this state?
I don't make you get into
this
state.
Yes, you do. I'm just playing at it.
When the Behind the Fridge tour came to the States, renamed Good Evening, Peter Cook was still turning up drunk on stage. Dudley decided to stay in America, this time for good, to try his luck as a film star.
He wanted to take on something that he wasn't able to do there, and that was to separate. He couldn't separate from...
It's 1973, and Dudley Moore has moved to Los Angeles to try his luck at being a Hollywood star. But Peter had other ideas. He talked Dudley into getting together in an American studio to record Derek and Clive.
Show me your ticket!
I don't want to show you my ticket, Mother.
Why not? I'm your
because,
mother.
Because, Mother, you're being very stupid. And you shut your face and die.
It's hard to believe that I'm hearing this.
It did very well. So there are a lot of, you know, filthy-minded people out there who love that kind of humour.
Derek and Clive's underground popularity led to spots on Saturday Night Live and Dudley landing a small part in Foul Play in 1978.
That, I believe, is what really started his career in Los Angeles.
His dream of becoming a film star had started to become true. He bought himself a beach house and started to embrace the Hollywood lifestyle of parties and group therapy.
He felt free for the first time in Hollywood, where everyone felt comfortable talking about all of their troubles. And he hadn't done that. He'd been very private. I think he was bipolar, actually, because he would be so high and so enthusiastic and then, you know, be on this low.
And he was in therapy, I think, on and off, more or less the whole of his life.
You don't go to an analyst to find out who you are. It's to find out how to get to what you know you are.
One of Dudley's fellow members of these group therapy sessions was Pink Panther director Blake Edwards, who struck up a friendship with Dudley and offered him the lead role in his new film. Dudley couldn't wait to tell his agent the news and called him during the session.
He whispered in the phone, "You may be getting a call. You may be getting a call. I gotta go back."
The film, of course, was 10, which paired Bo Derek with Dudley and made him an international star.
Perfect timing for him, middle age, perfect role.
If you remember, he was in sweat clothes because he had this childhood issue with his leg.
He talked to me about his clubfoot frequently because he loved the water, but he was too embarrassed to be in a bathing suit. So I'd always make sure we had, you know, homes and places that he could get in his bathing suit and come out and not have everybody watch it.
The public didn't notice the sweat clothes, and 10 turned Dudley into a sex symbol, something he never imagined in his wildest dreams.
What I'm interested in is the sex symbol part of it, you see. I mean...
Yes, I suppose you would be, Michael.
I just wondered if anybody could do it, you know.
If anybody could do it?
If there's hope for us all.
You can do it, Michael. I was just my charming self.
I mean, he was very handsome. He had an enormous talent, and women are besotted by talent. And also, in a strange way, because he was small, I think he exercised a little bit of the maternal instinct.
As well as being a heartthrob to the world, Dudley Moore always had a glamorous woman at his side. But his four marriages were always short-lived. Actress Susie Kendall in 1968. Then former child star Tuesday Weld in 1975, producing a son, Patrick. Then followed another actress, Brogan Lane, in 1988, and lastly, Nicole Rothschild in 1994, who had Dudley's other son, Nicholas. But back in 1980, Lou Pitt was on the lookout for another project for his star client when he got a hot new script that Dudley fell in love with immediately.
He called me maybe half a dozen times during the course of reading the script, and he said, I have to do this movie. It's the best script I've ever read.
Arthur was another role that seemed to be made for Dudley. Although not a drinker himself, he was the perfect drunk.
Where's the rest of this, Moose?
Arthur, I think it's time we got to know one another.
I do too. That's why I had you come over today. This is a tough room. I don't have to tell you that. You must have hated this, Moose.
Why don't you forget the Moose for a moment?
The thing about Dudley is likable. He was likable. I mean, and of course, it's very difficult to be a likable drunk.
Dudley Moore.
Arthur was an even bigger hit than 10 and earned Dudley the coveted Golden Globe Award for Best Actor and a nomination for an Oscar.
Oh, how nice it is to hold a heavy foreign object in one's right hand for once.
Although Dudley made another dozen or so films after Arthur, he never reached the same level of success again.
He wanted to work, and he said, you know what, tomorrow, this may be over.
Dudley could be very touchy. You had to be very careful when you... I mean, he would talk about all sorts of things, and you could laugh and joke about them. But when you spoke about his work, he was very sensitive, so one had to be careful.
Then, in 1995, Dudley heard the shocking news of the sudden death of his former comedy partner, Peter Cook.
Dudley was devastated. Peter's death.
And yet, when the press asked him, he couldn't really come out and say, I'm shocked, I'm heartbroken, I'm saddened. He just really had no way to express his feelings.
Dudley was a little wooden about Peter then.
Well, it's very strange to think of Peter having kicked the bucket.
There was still the affection there, but it had been sorely tested by Peter's problems.
Just a few months later, Dudley would have an even greater upset while acting on the set of Barbara Streisand's film, The Mirror Has Two Faces.
Barbara came up and she said, he has a serious problem, you need to... Is he okay, you know? Is he drinking? What's going on? He can't remember his lines. So he was in his trailer and they had broken we talked about it. And I said, if you can't get through the day, they're gonna have to replace you. He was in tears.
After this setback, Dudley retreated to his music. He and his friend, Raina Fruchter, were invited to tour Australia together.
It was a lot of fun. It was also the point at which he started having some problems with one finger.
Raina and her husband Brian were very worried, as was Dudley's friend Peter Bellwood.
I'm sitting there with him saying, you know, what the hell is it? What is it? I don't know.
Dudley then went on an exhaustive 3-year search in specialist clinics to find out what was causing these strange symptoms.
We all believed that this was something that could be solved, that could be cured. If we could only find what it was that was causing this, we could fix it.
Eventually, the doctors diagnosed progressive supranuclear palsy, a degenerative brain disease similar to Parkinson's. There was no cure.
It was very clear he couldn't work again, and that was maybe one of the saddest days I've ever had in my life.
Raina Fruchter, which I think is a very beautiful thing, basically said to him, I will look after you for however long it takes.
He was worried that he would end up on his own, and she became his carer, really.
In 1999, Dudley decided to tell the world about his condition by agreeing to an interview with American journalist Barbara Walters.
What do you most want people to know?
I want them to know that I'm not intoxicated.
You're not drunk?
No. And I just want them to know that I am going through this disease as well as I can.
At the end, he was listening to his songs without words when he died.
The actor, comedian, and musician Dudley Moore died this evening at his home in America. He was 66.
Learning that he had died and that this great talent had been lost to the world, it was a very sad moment.
But there's also a relief that the pain is over, the difficulty is over.
Dudley was an amazing part of my life. He definitely was my soulmate and a huge love and a huge loss.